Bibles tonight to John chapter number 11. John chapter number 11. For the next few moments, I'd like to look at this. Hopefully bring out some truths that have always been there, but maybe we didn't always see as being there. There may be some things that are refreshment to your mind. But let's look at this man named Lazarus. Let's look at what Jesus did for him. Let's look at how his sisters responded. Let's look at what it means to us in the light of eternity. So there's a lot to look at here this evening. I won't read everything at once, but what we'll do is, because we are probably familiar with it's not a parable, but something that happened, because we're familiar with it, I think that we can jump in and talk much about it. And the Bible says that there was a certain man that was sick named Lazarus. Are there more than one Lazarus in the New Testament?
Yes.
So this is not the Lazarus which did evil things in his life. Different Lazarus. All right, and he is known as being the sibling of Martha and Mary. And he was from Bethany, the town where the Bible says of Mary and her sister Martha. They were siblings, and they lived there together. And the Bible says it was Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair. Interesting that this, as of yet, had not happened. So when we look at it in chronological order, we see that Jesus visits with Lazarus. A little later, Mary will anoint his feet, and then there will be that of the crucifixion. Interesting how all this ties in to the crucifixion, with what's happening with Lazarus, with what was happening even with Mary with the alabaster box and anointing him. All of that was very symbolic of what was going to happen as Jesus came as the Messiah and he would die. And the Bible says, which wiped her feet with his hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister said unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. Now, if you were to look at this in the original text, it wouldn't be like just me giving word to you, Brother Eli. Brother Eli, I'm sick. That may, you may say, oh, Brother Saville must have the flu bug or the stomach bug, or he must have a cold. But the word and the wording in the original would have been that Brother Justin, he's sick and it's unto death. There's some things that they see. He's very sick. There's symptoms that they knew from history and what medical help that they would have or know that he is sick. And this does not look like there's a remedy to it. But he is sick unto death. And so, the one whom you love is sick. And the Bible says, I think most commentators, let me just say this here, we don't even know how everything is transpiring, but most people feel that they sent a messenger to Jesus. And as the messenger went, that Lazarus died before the word even got to Jesus. Verse number 4, when Jesus heard that, he said, the sickness is not unto death. Actually, the original text, from what I understand from commentators and what folks say, is that if the wording would be, it would be this, that he will not fall prey, P-R-E-Y, to death. He will not be a victim of death. He will not be someone that death overcomes and takes. And so when you look at this, Jesus says the sickness is not unto death. but that the God of glory, that the Son of Man might be glorified. Is God glorified in death and in sickness? He can be. But in death itself, I mean, as a child of God, that's our hope and that's where we rejoice. But in sickness and in death, it is a reminder that we live in a fallen world. And so there's really no, it shows that sin, the effects of sin, affects us in our life. But where God is glorified is when He heals bodies.
Amen.
And when He raises people from the dead. How many of you would love to see God raise someone from the dead? Yeah, it does, Brother Eli. I wonder how we would respond. Would we be prepared for it? You know, praying and asking God to raise someone. I have to think about that myself. How would I respond? And do I have the faith to believe that? Well, we should. We should. God can raise from the dead, can't He? And so God is glorified. He said, it's not unto death. You know, it looks like sin is won. It looks like death is the victor. But this is not unto death. But this is that God might be glorified thereby. Praise God.
Amen.
Now, Jesus loved Martha and his sister and Lazarus. You see, they were longtime friends. They were acquaintances. I shared this many years ago when I preached. You may not remember it, but I probably remember it much from my study. One of the things that I said, tried to bring out is, you know, there were many who were acquaintances or were not acquaintances who did not know God. I mean, He healed a lot of people. But this was His friend. There was a relationship that was established. And so God wanted to do something more for someone who He had a relationship with. So He raises him from the dead. May I say to us tonight that we are friends of God? Like Abraham, amen, a man that had friends must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. That is Jesus Christ. Amen. A greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. We are his friends. Amen. I believe God likes to do things for us because we are his friend.
Amen.
Amen. He likes to answer prayer. He likes to move in situations that seem very difficult. Amen. Maybe to the ordinary person, they would shake their head. Say, but we're a friend of God. So don't count God out because I know Him and He knows me. Praise God. So I think that's something we need to bank on, that we're a friend of God. When he had heard, therefore, that Lazarus was sick, amen, he hears that he's sick. The message is sent that he is sick. And he probably knows by the Spirit of the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost, that Lazarus has died. The Spirit of God speaks to him. Lazarus is dead. Jesus, the Bible says that he abode 2 days in the same place where he was. I believe a couple things here. I believe that God was Jesus and Jesus was God. I believe that God was, Jesus was anointed by the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost was speaking to him and he knew, yes, the word has come, Lazarus is dead, or is sick, but he's dead. But then the Holy Ghost says, wait 2 days. Wait 2 days. Jesus didn't live life haphazardly. He was about his Father's business. And he waits and he moves in the presence of God. It always pays to wait and listen to the Spirit of God. Lazarus is dead. Then he said to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. He's referring to, he had been there, he's going back, He's talking about being the good shepherd. The good shepherd takes the sheep from the jaws of the enemy, even if it means the good shepherd gives his life. And then he begins to talk to the disciples, and he says to him, his disciples said unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone you, and you are going there again? And you refer back to previous chapters. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? He's giving them this analogy. If a man walk in the day, he stumbles not because he sees the light of this world. Because of the earth and its rotation, the sun in the day is a light. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbles because there is no light in him. He's trying to say something to his disciples. He's saying, listen, disciples, I want you to know something. It's important for you to learn that you are not born with natural light. It's not natural for you to know the things and the plan and the will of God. But when you surrender to God and you walk by the Spirit of God, God will lead you. So here it is. He said, I'm being led by the Spirit of God. Amen. And this is the time. This is the light God has given me. These things he said, and after he said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleeps. Now he's not teaching soul sleeping here. He's simply saying this. He said, our friend Lazarus has died. His body is sleeping. We teach that, don't we, even from 1 Thessalonians? We teach that when someone dies, their body sleeps. But they are gone. They're in the presence of God. And so Jesus was making reference to the body of Lazarus. It sleeps. Now let me ask you this question. I know you don't know the answer, but I want you to think about this. So where is Lazarus at? He's in paradise. It's before the work of Calvary. It's before the crucifixion and the resurrection. So what's happened here is they didn't go to heaven, but they went to paradise. And that is where Lazarus is at this time, because Jesus, he doesn't have a glorified body. The work of Calvary is not finished. Jesus said this, but I go that I may wake him out of sleep. See, Jesus knew he was going to do something. He was walking in the Spirit, and God spoke to him and said to the Spirit, although he's God, the Spirit of God said, you're going to raise him from the dead.
Paradise
is what we see where the saints of God died and went to before Jesus died on Calvary. And so because of Calvary, now we have access to the blood of Jesus Christ. And because of the glorified body of Jesus Christ, he is the first fruits. And now we can be partakers of the fruits of having that glorified body, although they don't have their glorified body. But to be absent from the body now is to be present with the Lord. And you'll see when you look at Matthew 27, read that. Read it through. And it'll understand you. Where the saints, you'll see some walking. You'll see some things.
So what's the purpose of where they say you wait in whose belly or something?
Abraham's bosom?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're at the same place, but we're talking about before the work of Calvary. This is all before the work of Calvary.
Before Jesus came.
Before Jesus came, and even the 33 and a half years that he was here on earth ministering. It wasn't until the atoning work of Calvary that things changed. There became a new dispensation. Amen. And there became really such a lively hope. Paul talks about that lively hope. Peter talks about that lively hope. So that's what's happening here. Before the work of Calvary, Lazarus died. He goes to paradise. He's there. He's been dead for 4 days. That's where he's at. So it's very interesting to think about and talk about. But thank God for Calvary and the work. The disciples, they didn't understand what Jesus was talking about. It's amazing what sleep does to our body, isn't it? I last week got sick on Wednesday, and all I really did was just lay in bed the entire day. I got up for just a little spot of time and went back to bed that night. You know what my body was talking to me and saying? You need rest. Let me say this. Our bodies were designed for rest. And if we abuse our bodies, we will pay for it. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Why do you think God designed, and I don't want to get off on a tangent. Let's just say this. I want to challenge each of us, making sure that we take a day to rest. It is important for us to rest. We weren't designed to work 7 days a week. We were made for rest. So when our body speaks and says rest, we need to rest. And knowing that we in our life care for others, whether they're in our family or however, even ministry speaking, one of the greatest things that my supervisor will tell us at work at the hospital is, I will call you out on it. If I look at your life personally and I don't think that you're taking time to take care of yourself, I will call you out on that. And I will sit down with you and we will schedule you a day off. Because you don't do yourself any good. And you won't do anyone else any good if you don't rest. I was never taught that rule in my life. As an adult, I've learned that. Doesn't mean I lay around all day. But there are certain times where I'm not going to answer my phone if someone calls. They leave a message. It's critical. I'll get back with them. There are times where I need to be slotted out just to rest. And the disciples realized that Lazarus needed rest. However, they didn't realize that it was the rest. It was not the rest they were thinking. The disciples said, wow, he's sleeping. He's resting. He'll do good. And Jesus said unto them plainly. Sometimes Jesus has to speak pretty plain, doesn't he? He's dead. He's dead. I think that this shows us that even though they were close followers of Jesus Christ, sometimes they were dull to spiritual things. Sometimes we really need the Lord to speak to us. Plain and clear. Because sometimes our spiritual senses can be dull. We can be caught up and we can live in this world. And so Jesus said, he's dead. He said, I'm glad for your sake that I was not there. And Jesus was saying something. He said, listen, had I been there, Lazarus would have been healed. But I'm glad for your sake that I wasn't there. And he died. Because you need to see, amen, I want you to the extent of seeing this, that I can raise him from the dead. Nevertheless, let's go to him. Amen. Sometimes we just need to see the miracle working power of God because sometimes we are spiritually dull. We are. Thank God that he doesn't always do things our way. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us go that we may die with him. They don't really understand the whole kingdom of God. Then Jesus came. He found that Lazarus had been laid in the grave for 4 days. Now, a lot of commentators will say this, that it's on the fourth day that the body really begins to decompose after you've been buried in such a way that was traditional for their burial. So there was no, oh, he was swooned. Oh, there was no, he must have passed out and now regained consciousness. No, he's decomposing already. Jesus said, I'm going to show you my power. So God knew what he was doing. And then they came to Bethany, which was about 15 furlongs or 2 miles away. And many of the Jews came to Mary and Martha to comfort them. They were probably a wealthy family. A lot of people come. And then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, she went and she met them. Mary needed to stay at home. She was needing to be there because people were coming in and out. So Martha goes. And so once again, they both find their due place. And so Mary is still there. Martha doesn't want to cause disruption, destruction. She goes and she finds Jesus. And then Martha said to Jesus, "If you had been here, my brother had not died." Now there's a lot that Martha's saying. Does she anticipate that Jesus is the Messiah? I mean, does she know, but does she really know? I mean, she knows, but is she really cognizant? Is she really expecting? Is she really believing? But I know that even now, whatsoever you will ask of God, God will give it to you. Once again, even in her language there, is she realizing Jesus as the Messiah? She said, but whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you. Jesus said unto her, "Your brother, he shall rise again." Even though you're doubting, and I know you're going to misunderstand what I say, Martha, your brother's going to rise again. Martha said unto him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection of the last day." Jesus has just taught this in some previous chapters in John chapter number 6. And Jesus looked at her. Can I just pull you into this for a few moments? And Jesus looked at her. She knew that there's a hope. Isn't that the hope that we comfort ourselves with? I mean, if we had no hope in death, it would be very miserable. It would be heart-wrenching. But we have hope in death in Jesus Christ. Jesus looks at her. And this is how I imagine it. I'm not saying it happened this way. But he makes direct eye contact with her. And as he makes that direct eye contact with Joseph, he said, "I am the resurrection." You say, "Wait a second, Martha. I am the resurrection. I'm the life." So we're not talking about doctrines. We're talking about the deity of Jesus Christ, who he is. We can put all the doctrines aside. And when we know who he is, it becomes a reality. He is the resurrection. "He who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believes and believes in me shall never die." What a promise, what a hope, what a truth. That when we believe on Jesus Christ, we have the experience of eternal life. And then he asked her, "Do you believe?" "Yes. Yes. Yes, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world." Do you know what she was saying, Brother Eli? She was saying, "I believe. I believe that you are the seed of David. I believe that you are the hope of Israel, the one that has been longed for and expected for so long. Though I know you, but I really believe it. It has clicked. It's a reality. It's more than just a doctrine. It's more than just what I've heard. I believe you've experienced your Messiah." And when she had so said, she went her way. She called her sister Mary, called Mary her sister secretly, saying, "The Master is come and he calls for you." And as soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and she came to him. Now, Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in the place where Martha met him. Jumping down to verse number 32, then when Mary came where Jesus was, she saw him. She fell at her feet, at his feet. The falling at his feet, most believe, represents an anticipation for God to move in her need. Oh, how precious that when we fall at the feet of Jesus, it is symbolic of our anticipation for him to meet our needs. Lord, if you had been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, where have you laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. And then we come upon that shortest verse in the Bible. I don't know, this shortest verse, Brother Eli, was different to me as I studied this time. Jesus wept. I've often thought, Sister Beth, it's because he feels the pain, Lord Justin, of his friends. He wept. He felt the pain of loss of Lazarus. But it was more than that. Jesus felt the sorrow of what sin does in our life. He felt that, Brother Justin. That's what sin does. It kills. And he was saddened in his spirit. The loss of a friend, the grief of a family, the anguish of sin. And so he wept. The Bible says, and some said, could not this be the man which opened the eyes of the blind, which caused caused that even this man should have not died? Jesus therefore again groaned in himself, comes to the grave. It was a cave, stone laid upon it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Oh, Lord, by this time he stinks. He's been dead 4 days. Jesus said unto her, I said not unto you that if you would believe, you should see the glory of God. They took the stone, and Jesus, he lifted up his eyes. And we see him pray to the Father. The Bible says that when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he who was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and face bound with a napkin. And Jesus said unto him, loose him and let him go. Loose him and let him go. What happens when the voice of Jesus speaks to difficult situations, whatever they may be? But when Jesus speaks, outcomes are different. When Jesus speaks, outcomes are different. And I just want to stop right there tonight. Jesus.
So Mary Magdalene, that's Lazarus' mom.
No, this is Mary, the sister of Jesus. We have Mary Magdalene, who's different. It's not Jesus' sister. These are just friends of Jesus. Mary, Martha, and Lazarus are simply friends of Jesus who he has built and established relationships with. So when I have anything that they want to say on this account of a Lazarus. Oh, brother, you're right. That God would raise him from the dead.
Did he die a second time?
Yes.
He did.
But this time, if